It's your turn, I think.
Push the blue button when that stupid thing goes off. We have these new beepers, and they don't turn off, and it's really a pain. Unless you take the battery out, but you need a pin, a separate pin to take the batteries out, I guess they don't want us to be late. Anyway, we are so excited that Robert is here tonight, and I actually remember having read this book a long time ago, and Lois and I talked walking over here about how all the attorney conference should be required reading when we in fact get elected and during orientation, don't you think? Because in spite of all the rancor that you hear, and you see in the national news media, we actually do like each other, we respect one another, we get along very well. And the majority of people in the Congress do, you just never hear it. I mean, Tom Allen, our former colleague from Maine, who we miss terribly, was always part of our bipartisan group. And I'm hopeful that at some point in time, we're gonna start moving back to a more consensus-driven Congress as opposed to the rancor that exists there now. I know that Bill and Walter would certainly like that when my husband served in the Congress for 16 years before me and Jim McDermott was here part of that time. It was not like it is today. And so it's real important that we have opportunities like this tonight to share and kind of rise above politics and understand that, as Robert says, when you go out into the world, hold hands and stick together. It's dangerous out there, lonely too. Everyone needs someone. Some assembly is always required. And that, I think, says so much about what we need to do. But we thank you so much for being here tonight. And I just thank my good friend Lois for still being my friend. The fact that Joanna and I love each other, it's just, we're like sisters. We've come through some tough times in our lives. And to have a group called Faith in Politics that will capture our friendship and allow us to express our love for our husbands and those who preceded us here in a way that nothing else really could. It's very special, and it's very meaningful personally to both of us, to me. And to have this opportunity this evening to hear someone with a very distinctive take on civility, if you will. I just want to say one thing. We've been doing this for 10 years now. Well, actually, maybe 12? Oh, no, we've been doing the cast.
The lecture has, I think it's the 10th year.
Yes.
We did a little research to find out.
They were friends before that.
And they were friends before that, and we were here a little bit before that, but then this idea surfaced of a wonderful tribute, and it's actually so true how meaningful this is. Neither of them went through some of the recent sort of challenges that we have, and yet they, in their wisdom, would have understood it. And we, in that legacy of continuing a process of forming friendships across the aisle, that's really pretty basic, and it does start in kindergarten. And my background is not only as a parent, as Joanne is, but I worked a long time in early childhood education. And I think of circle time. I think of taking your shoes off and sitting in a circle and learning to do that and learning to listen, learning to be able to listen to somebody else tell their little story of what they got to show, their shoe, their new shoes or whatever it is. And then being patient through that process, and then they will turn around and listen to you. You know, when you think of it, I don't think we've mastered that here yet in Congress.
Sure.
And so there are a number of lessons that come right to the forefront of what you do in kindergarten that all seems to go by the wayside when we think we are big shots and have such major problems to solve. It's the same as sharing marbles on the playground. That's hard too. There are a number of things that are very challenging for kindergartners that that we could learn lessons from, and the aspirations that you have when you're young are the ones that we need to recall, because they are based on dreams and hopes and belief in opportunities, and that dreams can be realized. And our husbands both believe this. And you and you all are gathered here because we share that dream, and now we get to have the opportunity to have someone share with us how they have taken this dream and moved forward. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you so much.
I can imagine we might possibly have gotten Robert Fulgham to come to deliver this lecture had we started long enough ago and worked whatever connections we might have come up with if we'd done a lot of research. We didn't have to do that. We just simply had to call on our very good friend, Congressman Jim McDermott, who is a very good friend of Robert Fulgham, and ask him if he could speak to him about it. And he did, and he is here because of that. Jim, come on up and introduce Robert, if you will. Jim McDermott is one of the most faithful participants in everything related to faith and politics.
I am such a good friend of Robert's that I think this is the only time I've ever asked him to come and do anything. I've been asked many times by groups and people, and would you do this, would you do that, and I slip it. But this is one I really am very proud to have him here and pleased to have him here. Robert is really a very good friend, and so good a friend that he stayed with me last night in the upper room, and I asked him what he wanted me to say in his introduction. He said, "Be short and don't steal any of my stuff." So I want to tell you just two quick ways I know Robert. My son is a big, tall, rangy kid who plays basketball and was the captain of the state championship lacrosse team and an athlete and had no interest whatsoever in art. We couldn't get him to a museum or anything resembling anything artistic. But he happened to go to a school where he had to take an appreciation course in art. And so he went to the course, and he began bringing home pictures and whatnot. And then when it came Christmas time, I said, "What do you want for Christmas?" And he said, "I want one of those big books that lay on the coffee table. It's the complete works of Kurt Escher." And I was stopped dead in my tracks. I couldn't imagine my kid asking for this, but we got it for him, and he actually looked at it. And at the end of the first semester, he came to me, and he said, "I want $70. And I said, "What for?" He said, "I want to take a second course in art." And then I thought, I better go find out what's going on in this art class. That's how I met Robert. I went up to school, and we began a friendship that extended for a few years, and then came back after a few years, and I was going to run for Congress. I came back from where I was in Africa, and Robert showed up and said, "I'll help you run." So we went out and doorbelled in Ballard, and he's not above knocking on doors and watching dogs chase us down the street and whatever. But at one point he said to me, "Jim, I'd be glad to write a newsletter for your campaign." And I thought that was a great idea, so I told my campaign staff about what the excitement was that Robert was going to write a newsletter. And the campaign manager said, "I don't think he's a good enough writer to be writing for our campaign." This is at a time when he had a bestseller on the New York Times book list of All I Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. So he's still my friend in spite of my turning him down as editor of my campaign newsletter. And it is really my great pleasure to introduce to you Robert Fulgham.
The story you didn't tell was why he doesn't let me go on the hustings with him anymore. I never got out knocking on doors before, and Jim was with me, and knocked on this dead lady's door, and she had the door about open about this far, and I said, "I'm Robert Fulgham, I'd like to introduce you to Canada, the United States Congress," and she said, "We're not involved in politics." And I lost my temper. I said, "What the hell do you mean you're not lost in politics?" I kicked the door. I was so mad, and he never asked me to go with him again. I'm going to do something a little odd. I'm going to take a picture, and I'm going to use the picture later, so it's not just off the wall, but I'm going to take it for a personal reason. If you're a writer, you spend a lot of time alone, in solitude, and you think, does anybody care what I think?